So in this video, I want to have a look at how you can check your solution if it makes sense by using external reference like Google Maps, for example. So for that, I open up a new shot, and this is in camera tracking and then in Turin. This has been filmed by some very nice members of the Italian Blender community from Turin, and this should be very easy to track. So I will not explain anything. I will just show you the time lapse where I put the markers and stuff, but other than that, it should be totally easy to track that. But since this is an open place in Turin, you might want to be able to check if everything makes sense. And for that, you can use external reference. So in the meantime, I have tracked the scene, and I have to admit it was a little bit tedious because this thing right here went always in the way. So I had to make sure that these markers did not slide. So I had to sometimes disable them manually. So that was a little bit tedious and time consuming. And well, but other than that, it was pretty nice to track. Of course, the next step is to try to solve that. So let's set these camera data. Now I know that this shot has been recorded with a Canon 5D and also that the lens has been 17mm lens, and that has also been noted here right there in the file name. So we can just go ahead and set this to the Canon 5D and then make sure that the focal length is set to 17mm, like that. Let's first try with the default settings here. But I somehow doubt that this will give the best results, because a 17mm lens will most likely have some lens distortion. Okay, so we've got 1.4 average solve error, which is not that good. So this really doesn't look right. So that is our camera curve, the error per frame. If I enable all the markers, then we can first check if everything's all right. So it looks quite okay. There are no really bad spikes. Oh, maybe this one. I think that might be a bit dangerous. So what's happening here? So there. Oh, that's this one. Okay, so that is a little jump and we can correct that. Of course, only this one. Like so. By the way, that is a very typical shape. So when you have something like that, where you have this shape, this up and down, then you know that you can just put the marker back on place and on the next frame it will be okay again. So that is always something that you can very easily correct. But if the marker would have jumped away and then on this frame continue to track that, then you have a very different shape. So then you have this one jump, and after that it will be flat again. So you don't have this up and down, but just up and then on the same level. So that is something where you can, or where you have to correct everything that comes after that. But if it's really just up and down, so then in the path you have this spike, but in the curve view you will have this up, down, up. So that is very easy to correct. G, put it back in place. Now we also have this smooth curve here. But well, other than that, it looks okay. So everything is pretty smooth. So in theory, we should get a much better value here. So, of course, we have to correct something. And first of all, we can try if we can improve that by choosing different keyframes. So let's see, we have on frame 1, it's here. Then on frame 30, it looks like that. But I must say that this should be really enough to establish the perspective. So I think that the keyframes are all right. We might try to set it to something, I don't know, maybe here. So 250 and 290. But still, we get the same value here. So maybe we can try to enable the refinement, Shift S. And well, that didn't really help. So for some reason, Blender has not been able to trigger the refinement. So in that case, we now have to try to find out the distortion values manually. So we go to tracking and then set this to the distortion mode. Then we can also hide the curves. So press Z. And now we should try to find some straight lines, which in this case is very easy. So we go to Grease Pencil. And either we click here and then create a straight line, or we do that with shortcut by holding down the D key and the Control key, then left click here, keep the mouse pressed, and now we can place this line over here. Maybe a little bit more accurate, so let me try again. From here to there, all right. Then also, this of course should be a straight line, but I can already see that this is kind of curved. So D, Control, click here, move that down there, and you can see that the line is not really lining up with the line that we see here. So the footage is kind of bent, so it's not as straight as it should be. Of course, you never know if the lines in the footage are really 100% straight, but in this case, chances are that these lines are really straight lines. Okay, like that. And now we can try to manually set the lens distortion. So first of all, let's put this to some negative value. So draw the K1 slightly into the negative direction. And when you are in distortion mode, then here in display, you have automatically the manual calibration enabled. So you will see the effect of this manual lens distortion calibration in the grease pencil. So when you draw this to the negative direction, then this lines up a little bit better now. Also here, that looks better. But just from experience, I know that when I drag the K1 value into the negative direction, then if I would be able to use the automatic calibration for K2, then the K2 value would be something in the positive direction. And by using that, I will drag this back so that this is now bent again. So I have to work against that with the K1 value. And here, like that, I can start to adjust that so that this fits. Okay, let's try again. Tab key to go back to tracking mode. And I keep the refinement enabled. And eventually, the manual calibration can now help us to trigger the automatic refinement. So Shift S to solve, and that looks very promising. So if refining takes a little bit longer, then it really tries to calculate something. And now look at that. We are at 0.5, which is perfect. We also see that the focal length is still at 17 and that our manual calibration here was not too bad. So changing these values has now been able to trigger the refinement, so that should now be a pretty great solution. So let's have a look at that in 3D view. Maybe before we can just get rid of that grease pencil, like that, and then again divide that, go to 3D view, then scroll down here to get to the clip settings, then enable setup tracking scene. And before we continue, of course, we have to set the floor. So for the orientation, we pick some markers that are on the floor, of course. And in that case, I want to use something here because that is not flat on the ground, that goes up a little bit. So for that I will use this one, and maybe that one. Then tap to go to the reconstruction mode, set floor. Then also we can already set some origin. So maybe this one could be our origin, like that. And because this is nicely in line, I pick this one and then set this as y-axis. But if I press 7 to look from above, then I would rather have that in the opposite direction. So I click on y-axis again so that the camera is now here. And we've got these markers now here indicating where our buildings are. All right, like that. Then N to be able to go to the motion tracking panel so that we can make the size a little bit bigger. Also, maybe let's set a scale. So let's see, the typical height of a door is maybe 2 meters. So I can pick these and then say set scale is 2 meters, the distance of these, like that. Okay, so let's start inserting some geometry. So maybe full screen, then Control Alt Q for the quad view. Then I want to adjust that so that this now sits on the floor. Then also maybe use this plane to try to line that up. So let's see, in the first frame, I need the timeline here. Okay, maybe here. This should be lining up to that line. And of course, let's not forget to also enable the proxy, just so that the camera view is able to use the render undistorted feature. So enable the checkbox here, proxy timecode. And then in the 3D view, you can see that automatically the background images are now able to use this setting, render undistorted. So now we have straight lines in the footage, and that will of course fit much better to the geometry here. So that looks good. Then scale that up along the y-axis. So that could be better, but I think it's still okay. Maybe we can even rotate this just a little bit. So now that lines up nicely, like so. Then in wireframe, could also try to line that up here like that. Yeah, that looks fine. And now if I want to match that to this line, then I know that these are probably in line, these blocks. So if I look at that, of course, that one, this one, these should be, I mean, or should they? I don't know. Maybe they should, at least I would think that they are in a rectangle to this line. But if I now insert a plane here to match these, then that really doesn't fit at all. I mean, it's not terribly bad, but this is definitely not a line. So, well, first of all, this of course goes not flat, but this is slightly uphill. I don't know the correct word for that. So right here at our origin, I will first of all make sure that the origin is here by first centering the cursor there, then go to origin, set cursor. So now I can press R and then Y to rotate that. And also should be here like that. Yes, R, Y a little bit more, like so. Then E to extrude. And well, it doesn't really line up that nicely. So that doesn't really fit. So something seems to be wrong. And now, well, I mean, we could of course try to fix our curves or get a new solution. But, well, it would be just easier to know exactly if that makes sense or not if you could somehow find out if this is really exactly that what it should be. And in that case, it really helps to use a map for reference. So if you know where this has been shot, then just use a map or go to Google Maps and look it up. So eventually, this is just not straight line, but maybe this is in fact just not rectangular. So in our example, I know that this has been recorded in Turin. So of course, we can just look it up. Turin in Italy. So that is here. And then let's have a look if we can find this place. So here we've got the city. And then we should look for a place. It seems to be the center of town. So there are some places here. Maybe let's zoom in a little bit more. And that already looks familiar here. So if I zoom in a little bit more, then that is the place. So here you can see we have these curved lines of this building that you can also see here. So that is this. Then we've got these lines on the floor. And in fact, they are not straight. So we've got here our lines. The camera would be somewhere around here. And well, that is not rectangular. That is a little bit different here. So these are our markers that we have here. So here, 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 and here we've got place our markers. So in fact, our solution is kind of okay. And maybe we can really find out if it is really correct by taking a screenshot and bringing that into Blender. So I will just use my screen grab tool. That is, in this case, the one from OS X. So I've taken this screen capture and then I go back to Blender. Now, of course, I could just use the background images, but because the image in Google Maps has been rotated slightly, I rather want to use an empty for that. So Shift A and then add an empty. And here in the empties properties, you can go to the display options and set it to display an image. Like that. Then just click on open and navigate to the folder with your screen grab and import that. Like so. And of course, I want to scale it up a little bit. So S and then scale. Something like that. Then also, let me just bring that down here so that it is slightly below our markers. Then 7 to look from the top, like that. Maybe lower the transparency a little bit. And now we can try to line that up. So first, let's line up the origin of our scene on this block, that one right here, with a block in the footage. So we have to scale it, and then I think that this might be this block. So let's press G and then bring that here to the origin of the scene, like so maybe. And then also press Shift C to make the cursor go to the center of the scene. Then make sure that the pivot point is also set to 3D cursor, like that, so that we can now press R and then not rotate around the origin of the object, but around the origin of the scene or around the 3D cursor. So R to rotate that until it is lining up, more or less, like that. And now we can start scaling so that these points in the corner are here where I suspect that the actual points might be. Now, S to scale it up until these points are on this corner, more or less, something like that. And now you can see that here our points that we have marked here, these tracks, are in fact at the correct positions, and also they are in line with this line from this image here. And even the points that we have marked on the roof of this building here, maybe not exactly, but more or less, they are in fact lining up. So at least we know that this line is correct. And then, of course, with that information, it's very easy to just put in everything you want in your scene. So it's a really good idea to get some reference. So whenever you're shooting outside, then you can just use Google Earth or Google Maps or just regular maps and use that as a reference. Or if you're shooting indoors, then maybe you just want to measure the whole set so that you exactly know what the dimensions are, if lines are straight or how big they are, or, you know, whatever your set might look like. So if you know the exact dimensions and the exact appearance of your set, then it will be much easier for you to really know if your solution is correct and then to implement the stuff in that. Or maybe you also realize that some lines are just not, for example, rectangular where they should be. So then you might have to go back and have a look at your solution and maybe adjust something. So having a reference is always a good idea.